Chapter 21, The Immune System, or known as Non-Specific Body Defenses and Immunity. So our body has some innate defenses. There are two types. There are surface barriers and internal defenses. Surface barriers are considered to be the body's first line of defense and include skin and mucous membranes. Internal defenses include phagocytes, NKC, or natural killer cells, fever, inflammation, and antimicrobial proteins. There are also adaptive defenses, which include humoral immunity, which have B cells. And B cells produce and respond to an infected cell with antibodies. And then there's cellular immunity, which have T cells. And T cells detect receptors on the outside of infected cells and uses cytokines to take care of that infected cell. So back to innate defenses. For surface barriers, we have skin, which is a physical barrier that inhibits pathogens and encourages normal flora of growth. So the skin is our first protective layer. It protects us from anything trying to get into our body. And then there's the mucous membranes. And there's a few of them. There's eyes, which have tears that can wash away microorganisms. You have your nose, which has hair that catches dirt and bugs and anything trying to get up inside your nose. They also have goblet cells, which produce mucus, which also aids in keeping things from getting in your nose and your respiratory. In your GI, you have acid in the stomach, which kills most bacteria. And then in the GU, you have your urethra, which has an acidic environment. And most microorganisms cannot survive in an acidic environment. And then, more on the innate, there is some internal. So you have the phagocytes. And you have two types. You have macrophages, which are a sign of chronic infection, and the neutrophils, which are the first responders, a sign of acute infection. Macrophages come after an infection has been there for a while, and the neutrophils are there when the infection first begins. Macrophages eat the dying cells. Well, they eat the cells and they cause them to die. This is what a macrophage looks like. This is a neutrophil. You know it's a neutrophil based on its multi-lobe. It's got three lobes right here. The action that takes place with the phagocytes is they engulf the pathogen, they form around it, they fuse with lysosomes, and then if the pathogen resists, then they do a respiratory burst, which is additional killing chemicals. Then it does opsonization, which is the process of adding specific carbohydrates and proteins on the outside of the bacteria. And then, defensins, which is a substance made by a neutrophil, and it pokes little holes into the infected cell to get rid of it. Alright, so here we have a natural killer cell. So, it's not a phagocyte. It releases perforins into the cell, and it causes perforated little holes to go in there. It pokes holes into the infected cell after they meet together, and then the cell starts to dissolve on its outer layer. It promotes inflammatory response as a result. So, once inflammation begins to occur, there are some chemicals that are very, very important. You have histamine, which is the inflammatory response itself. You have kinds and prostaglandins, which are the pain messengers. You have complement, and then you have lymphokines, which are chemical messengers produced by lymphocytes. And then the area begins to expand. The actions start with vasodilation, hyperemia, which produces more of a blood flow. So the vessels open up, more blood is coming. Increased local vascular permeability, so more fluids are able to move through. And then you get extra fluid, and then you get swelling, or exudate, and edema. Now we're going to talk about antimicrobial proteins, the complement system. So the actions are, it's direct lysis of pathogens, opsonization, which if you don't remember, opsonization is a process of adding specific carbohydrates and proteins to the outside of bacteria, and it aids in the inflammation response. And then it consists of C1 through C9, factors B, D, and propertin, and regulators. There are two complement pathways of the antimicrobial proteins. There is the classic pathway, which begins with AGAB complex, which binds to a C1, and then that makes C4 and C2 join complex, and then C3 has a cleavage, and then it becomes the common pathway. And then there's an alternative pathway, which factors B and D and bupropion, and they bind to a pathogen wall. A complex is formed, and then they join the common pathway. The common pathway is a C3 cleaved into C3A and C3B. C3A stimulates inflammation. C3B does the opsonization, which again, opsonization is when you process of adding specific carbohydrates and proteins on the outside of a bacteria. It binds to the target cell, and an enzyme cascade of activation happens. So they bind to it, and then the enzyme takes over. And then another part is C5 is cleaved into C5A and C5B. C5A helps with inflammation, and C5B is an enzyme cascade. So to remember, A's are for inflammation, and B's are for enzymes. Cellular immunity is when the T cells deal with the cell-to-cell contact, and then humoral is antibodies and the killing force protecting for both the inside and the outside of cells. If you look over here at the diagram, we're going to start with a cell that has an antigen. And then this is a B cell. So the B cell splits. And it splits into two. It makes an exact clone. And then this one over here on the left turns into two plasma cells. And the plasma cells, the plasma B cells, secrete antibodies. And this other B cell here on the right produces a plasma cell to make antibodies, but it also produces a memory B cell. So the memory B cell finds the antigens and it clones, and the clones of cells identical, and then it keeps making more of these cells. It keeps making plasma cells and memory B cells. So that the next time that this pathogen or bacteria is found in the body again, the body remembers how to take care of it and get rid of it so you don't get sick again. So cells of the immune system. So there are lymphocytes, which are found in red bone marrow, or at least the B cells are, and the T cells are immunocompetent in the thymus. And macrophages eat and act as antigen-presenting cells. Types of cells in the immune system include neutrophils, eosinophils, basophils, lymphocytes, monocytes, and macrophages. Each one of these types of cells have a special way to go around in the body and take care of different things that the body needs taken care of. All right, so active immunity. There are two types of active immunity, naturally acquired and artificially acquired. Naturally acquired is from when you get sick and then you get better. Your body produces those memory cells, those antigens, so that the next time you get sick or the next time that disease comes around, you won't actually get it, and your body will be protected from it. And then there's artificially acquired, which are vaccines, and there's three types. There's toxoid, live, and dead. And you can see right there what those mean. Problems that may occur when you get vaccines is you may need boosters after a few years. Some of them you have to have like renewed every so often. And then another problem that could be is that if you get that vaccine, you can come in contact with that virus and you can actually get sick if your body doesn't make the immune to it. That being said, the problem and the risk is so low that it's better to get the vaccinations than not. Vaccinate your kids. So there's passive immunity as well. And there's two types. There's naturally acquired, which you usually get through your mother because you're sharing blood, you're sharing nutrients, and as that stuff's flowing through you when you're born, Sometimes, not everything, but for a good part of it, you are naturally immune from things you get from mom. And then there's artificially acquired, which is like anti-venom and shots. You can get shots and it'll help you make immune antibodies and stuff so that you don't get sick again. There are classes of antibodies. There are five classes. There is IgG, which is the most common. It's the main produced in the plasma and in any immune response. There's IgM, which is the first antibody produced. It's the primary response, and it's made of five antibodies hooked together. There's AGA, which is a dimer. It secretes antibodies in the sweat and the saliva. AGE is allergic response. It binds to mast cells and basophils. It's what happens when you have an allergic reaction to something, be it peanuts, be it a bee sting. And then there's IgD, which is found on the outside of B cells. Also, it's important to remember that genes cause the variability in antibodies. So the different genes cause the different variations in the antibodies. Cell-mediated response. So, if you look at this diagram, it's going to start over here with this macrophage. The macrophage eats the infected cell. And the infected cell, after it gets eaten, some of its receptors get put on the outside of the macrophage. And then memory T cells hook onto it, and a helper T cell hooks onto it and releases cytokines to the memory T cell. The memory T cell goes through mitosis and makes a bunch of copies, and then the next time there is another infected cell with that same virus, the killer T cell attaches and then releases cytokines in around the cell, and it eats it away until it's a dead infected cell. Another way to look at it is the cytotoxic T cell, or the killer cell that releases the cytokines, the helper T, or the T4, which is simulated CD8 cells and simulated B cells. Steps of T cell activation. It starts with recognition and MHC restriction for clonal selection and differentiation of T cells. A T cell must simultaneously identify a non-self antigen and a self antigen, and does this with the help of major histocompatibility complex, or MHC. There's class 1 MHC, which are proteins, and they synthesize in all body cells except for red blood cells, bind to some protein fragments that is synthesized within the cell. The fragment is either self or non-self. And then it's incorporated into the cell surface where it's displayed. And then there's class 2 MHC proteins, which synthesize only in antigen-presenting cells and act as signals for immune cell recognition for each other. Bind exogenous antigens that have been phagocytized or lysized in vacuoles, incorporated into cell surface where it is then displayed. So if you look at the diagram, if you look at the macrophage where it's presenting these the infected cells outer part, and then they absorb it, and then the next time that infected cell comes around, the T cell, the killer T cell, has that displayed on its outside surface so that it can take care of that infected cell and kill it so that the person doesn't get sick. Another something important is to think about cytokines. There's monokines, which come from macrophages, and macrophages cause inflammation and fever. There are lymphokines, which are from the T cells, and they're helper T cells. They cause growth in B and T. They divide, they differentiate, and they cause more division. There are And then there's three types of T cells. There's helper T cells, cytotoxic T cells, which attack other cells by binding to them, as you can see, and then releasing the perforin. And then there's suppressor T cells, which turn down the immune system. So it's important to know about T cells because of something called a certain type of transplant. So organ transplants. So there are a few different types. There is an autograft, which is where you take something like your own skin from a burn, for example. Let's say you burn your arm and you take skin from your leg and they put it on that place on your arm. If they take an autograft is when they take it for somewhere on you and put it somewhere else on you. Then there's an esograft. An esograft is between identical twins. There's a xenograft, which is a graft between different species. And then there's an allograft, which is between the same species. So for identical twins, it's like if you need a certain organ, for example, kidneys. Usually identical twins will, well, I guess they always will have compatibility, and they also have blood compatibility. And then with a xenograft, certain parts of certain animals can be used with humans because the genome is very similar. And then an allograft is a graft between some of the same species. It could be someone who has a matching liver to you to grow a new liver or something along those lines, blood. And then to prevent rejection, they have to turn down the immune response. And they do that with immunoresponse therapy. So there are some homeostatic imbalances of immunity. So one section is immunodeficiencies. There is severe combined immunodeficiency disease. You don't have any immune system. The best example I can give is if you've ever seen one of those movies where they have like a bubble boy or a bubble girl where they have to live inside a bubble. They can't go outside because they're basically allergic to everything, and their bodies are so fragile because they don't have an immune system that they could die. Another is acquired immune deficiency syndrome or AIDS. It's caused by HIV and it attacks the T cells, and then your body isn't able to fight off disease like it used to. There are hypersensitivities, which is immediate type hypersensitive type 1 reaction, which begins within seconds. It's basically like an allergic reaction, anaphylaxis. Binds and then it begins to dump histamine in the body, and the body begins to swell. My example is like someone with a peanut allergy. They touch peanuts within seconds, their body is starting to swell, their airways trying to close, they can't breathe. There is subacute, which happens within hours. That is like cytotoxin 2 reaction, which is like a mismatched blood transfusion. And I have here is this person is an A positive and needs a blood transfusion. If you give them B negative blood, you could kill them. The immunocomplex 2, which is too many antigen and antibodies in the blood. And there's just too much floating around there. And then there's delayed, which happens within days. And the example of that is something like poison ivy, contact dermatitis, stuff like that. So like if you touch poison ivy, it may not happen right away, but within 24 hours or so. Your skin's gonna start getting little red blotches, it's gonna get itchy, and it's gonna be uncomfortable. You can also it can also cause negative reactions, graft rejection, that kind of stuff. And then there's, last but not least, there are immune autoimmune diseases, and examples are those are multiple sclerosis, lupus, rheumatoid arthritis, and this is when the body triggers itself and begins to attack itself. It's when your body sees its own cells and its own like parts and everything as a foreign invader when it's not supposed to see it as a foreign invader. And it begins to attack itself. And that's really bad because then the body begins to tear down. That was chapter 21, The Immune System, or known as Nonspecific Body Defenses and Immunity.